Constitution Day, the National Law Day, also known as the Samvidhan Divas, is celebrated every year on 26th November to commemorate the adoption of Indian Constitution by the Constituent Assembly of India, which came into effect on 26th January 1950.
The Government of India declared 26th of November as Constitution Day on 19th of November 2015 by Gazette notification. The Prime Minister of India, Shah Narendra Modi, made a declaration on 11th of October 2015 while laying the foundation stone of the B.R. Ambedkar Statue of Equality Memorial in Mumbai. The year 2015 was the 125th birth anniversary of Ambedkar, who had chaired the drafting committee of the Constituent Assembly and had played a pivotal role in the drafting of the Constitution. Previously, this day was celebrated as Law Day, but later, 26th of November was chosen to spread the importance of the Constitution and to spread the thoughts and ideas of Ambedkar.
Preamble to the Constitution is rightly referred to as the soul of the Constitution. It is a brief introductory statement that sets out the guidelines for the people of India and presents the principles of the Constitution. It reflects the hopes and aspirations of the people. The preamble can be referred to as the preface, which highlights the entire Constitution. It was adopted on 26 November 1949 by the Constituent Assembly, but it came into force on 26 January 1950, which is celebrated as Republic Day in India.
We,
the
people of
India,
having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic and to secure to all its citizens
justice, social, economic and political liberty of thoughts, expression, belief, faith and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and the integrity of the nation.
In our Constituent Assembly, on this 26th day of November 1949, do hereby adopt, enact and give ourselves this Constitution.
The first Indian Constitution was drafted in March 1874. It was the product not of British India, but of Indian India, as princely states were termed. It was in the princely states that Indians had the chance to exercise a modest degree of self-governance, which is why the first constitution drafted in modern India emerged there.
The Indian Constitution is also inspired by the Constitution of the USA. The principle of fundamental rights, impeachment of the president and removal of judges, and the power of judicial review, which gives the judiciary an upper hand in interpreting the Constitution. The judiciary can thus nullify any order by the legislature or executive if that order is in conflict with the Constitution of the country.
A lot of concepts and features of the Indian Constitution have its roots in Great Britain. Some of those are parliamentary form of government, in which the country is governed by a cabinet of ministers led by the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister is the head of the government, whereas the President, that is the nominal head, is the head of the state. Rule of law, which basically states that a state is not governed either by the representative or by the people, but only by the law of that country. The concept of rule of law states that everyone is equal before law, even the ones making it. Article 14 of the Indian Constitution codifies the rule of law.
Most importantly, the Act established the office of the Governor. All executive powers and authority of the centre was vested in the Governor. Some features of the Government of India Act 1935 were Federal Legislator. The Act suggested that the legislator will have two houses, that is, the Council of States and a Federal Assembly. Provincial Autonomy. This Act enabled the provincial governments to be responsible only to provincial legislators and helped them break free from external control and intrusion. It was within the establishment of this Act that the powers between the centre and provinces were divided in terms of three lists. Federalist, Provincialist and Concurrent List. The residuary powers were handed over to the Viceroy.
The Constitution of 1950 was a byproduct of the legacy started by the Government of India Act 1935. This was the longest act passed by the British government, with 321 sections and 10 schedules.
Today, it has been an year since the Constitution of India came into existence. And to celebrate its existence, we shall be interviewing three prominent members of the Constituent Assembly, Rajendra Prasad, Vallabhai Patel and Dr. Ambedkar. Today, it has been a year since the Constitution of India came into existence. And to celebrate its existence, we shall be interviewing four members of the Constituent Assembly, Rajendra Prasad, Vallabhai Patel, Durgabai Deshmukh and Dr. Ambedkar.
One of the basic principles that I believe is in unity. Something that inspired me to put my all for the integration of the independent territories into one united nation called India. My hope for the Indian Constitution is that it continues to uphold this law after I am gone. There is no sugarcoating about it, but I have full faith on our people. India shall emerge as a more stronger and united country. The partition has taken a toll on this country. I wish India to become a land that accepts the people of every culture, religion and welcomes everybody with open arms.
I've had the privilege of holding the positions of a teacher, a lawyer, a minister and a freedom fighter. These positions have taught me that the youth are the future of our nation. My term as a Minister of Food and Agriculture has taught me that a well-developed agricultural state is of utmost importance. My tenure as a teacher and lawyer has instilled the value of education in me. And my participation in nationalist movement has taught me the value of collaboration. My hope for the Constitution is that no matter how many changes my country goes through in the future, the values that I have learned through pain and sacrifice continue to be enshrined in it. And that each and every person recognizes the importance of these values.
As a Dalit, what discrimination have you faced, consciously or unconsciously, by others around you?
No matter how idealistic our approach to the Indian society may be, I have faced quite a lot of discrimination while growing up, practicing law, and even during the national struggle. In fact, not even a day has passed when I have not felt the very presence of the fact that I am a Dalit. So, my main motive is to ensure that generations who are going to come after me do not have to face what I had to face and can prosper in a way that generations before them never could.
Could you tell us about the Constituent Assembly and how it felt to be a part of it?
Being a part of the Constituent Assembly and being allowed to chair multiple sessions was truly an honor. I would like to thank my fellow freedom fighters and lawmakers for allowing me to serve my country in such manner. The Assembly very thoughtfully debated each topic, each article and each clause. While it would get tiring sometimes as the debates would stretch on, we knew it was the best for interests of people. Overall, it was a memorable experience.
Being a part of the Constituent Assembly was once-in-a-lifetime opportunity I was fortunate enough to have. I was able to utilize my capabilities and my knowledge to the best. I had the opportunity to work with the brightest minds our country has ever had to figure out ways to ensure a brighter future for our Indian citizens. I'm deeply grateful to them for entrusting us with this job and having full faith in our capabilities.
Fundamental rights are certain legal rights that are guaranteed to every citizen irrespective of caste, creed, religion, gender or place of birth. These are enshrined in Part 3 of the Constitution and are mentioned from Article 12 to 35. These are taken from Constitution of USA, where they are known as Bill of Rights. Fundamental rights are also described as Magna Carta of India. These include
culture and educational rights laid down in Article 2930 provides protection against interest of minorities and gives the freedom to get admission in educational institutions. It guarantees the right to minorities to establish educational institutions to preserve and develop their own culture and prohibits discrimination while giving any grants.
Right to Equality, incorporated in Article 14 to 18, states that the state shall not deny to any person's equality before law or the equal protection of law within the territories of India. It prohibits discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste, gender or place of birth. It further provides for equality of opportunities in matters of public employment and abolishes untouchability while clarifying that nothing in this article shall prevent the state from making any provision for the reservation of the appointment or post in the favor of any backward class of the citizens.
Fundamental duties. Rights and duties are two sides of the same coin. There are no duties without rights and no rights without duties. Fundamental duties were not included in original constitution but were added by 42nd Amendment Act 1976. Article 51A Part 4 deals with fundamental duties. Fundamental duties include
Right to Constitutional Remedies, incorporated in Articles 32 to 35, was considered as the heart and soul of the Constitution by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar because it gives the citizen a right to approach a High Court or a Supreme Court to get any of the fundamental rights restored in case of their violation. The court can issue various special orders known as writs or directives to the government for the enforcement of these rights.
Fifth, to promote harmony and brotherhood and to respect women. Sixth, to preserve rich heritage and composite culture. Seventh, to protect and improve natural environment including wildlife, forests, rivers, etc. Eighth, to develop scientific look and humanism.
Abide by the constitution and respect our national flag and anthem to follow the noble ideals that inspired our country's national freedom movements, to defend the country when need arises, to protect the unity and integrity of India,